Well, we want to welcome you today to the service for Miss Evelyn. Many of you know her, as you're going to learn if you didn't know about her, and I know if you're here, you did, but some wonderful stories that are going to be shared this morning and some memories, of course, that many of you have made with her. I want to start by reading a scripture from John 14. These are the words of Jesus. He says in verse number 1, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And whither I go, you know, and the way you know. Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? And Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." Lord, thank you for this family. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to reflect on a life that has been well lived. Lord, as we reflect during the next few moments on Miss Evelyn and her family and the memories that have been made, Lord, I pray that you'd help us to understand the words of Christ and to understand our days and the time that we've been given. So, Lord, help us to not only pray for, but to support and lift up this family during this time. And Lord, may this service be one that honors you and also, Lord, memorializes Miss Evelyn. Thank you once again for the opportunity to share and reflect. And Lord, we ask all these things in your Son's name. Amen. Well, at this time, the family is going to make remarks, and they wanted me to ask if anyone wanted to share. You have an opportunity to do that. You can either right there, or you can come right here and you can share a story, an anecdote, something from the life of Miss Evelyn, a friendship, but whatever you'd like to do, you can come and do that at this time.
Thanks, Pastor Jason. Well, thank each one of you for coming today. And I'd like to start off by thanking my sister-in-law, Joanne, for the pictures and a lot of the work that was done to prepare for this, for my brother, for the obituary that he wrote, which I thought was very good. But I also wanted to take just an opportunity to share a couple of personal stories about my mom growing up. And I think first, I think every or most of us would probably feel that their mom was patient, kind, gentle, loved her family, was hardworking. But I'm going to give you a couple of short stories that kind of, I guess, exemplified those things. I remember as a young child, I was about 4 years old, and I used to run barefoot in the yard all the time. And so we went out on one particular day, and Mom said, "I want you to put your tennis shoes on." And I said, "No, I don't want to put them on. I want to go barefoot." She said, "Well, you're going to have to put them on today." So I said, "No, I'm not putting them on." And of course, my dad wasn't there at the time, or I probably wouldn't have said that. But in any event, she says, "Well, yes, you are going to put them on." I said, "Well, no, you can't catch me." And she said, "Yes, I can." So I took off. I got three steps. She had me with her right hand, and the left hand was applying the correction to the seat of knowledge. So she was a strong-willed person, but in a quiet way, typically. You'd have to flee from her in order to see have the wrath applied, I guess. In addition to that, Mom was a very hard worker. And I say that a lot of, we've probably run into a lot of people that we think are hard workers. I remember Bill Watson, I worked for him, Watson Realty, as he was the president of it. I was the chief financial officer. And I was sitting there talking with him one day, and he said, "You know, Phil," he said, "three people remind me of very hard workers." He said, "One's a lady that started her own agency. She used to work with me. myself, and he says, you're the third one. But I paled in comparison to her work ethic. She was a multiple $10 million producer multiple years. And our close friend Janelle Bales will probably let you know that's a pretty difficult thing to achieve. And that was 20 some odd years ago. She also ran a nursing home when we were kids for about 3 years along with my father. And that required some long hours and diligence. And she loved her family. And I guess the best way I can describe that, because she was patient, kind, and loving, you very rarely hear her say anything out of the way to anyone. But on one particular occasion, I was playing Little League Baseball, and I went up to the bat, and apparently my legs were a little thinner than some of our opponents had found to be acceptable. So this one girl in the audience said, he can't hit, he's got bird legs. And so, it was kind of a motivator for me, but I found out later on that Mom had leaned over to the girl in front of some of the other people in the stands and said, if you ever looked in the mirror, you'd never, make any comment about anyone else's legs. But I did get a double on that trip to the bat. So anyway, I think what we're here to do is to celebrate her life. She was here 92 years, and she had a full life and a wonderful life. She was a wonderful mother, wife, and beautiful person. I want to just take a couple of minutes also to thank Sandy, Tiffany, and Abigail for coming this morning. They assisted Mom for about the last year and a half in her care. And it was really a divine appointment that they arrived. I mean, I consider it a privilege to have met them. I mean, they're just such lovely people. And they love Mom. Every time they would arrive, they'd go over and hug her and tell her that they loved her. And I think that was true. It was really not a job for them. It was really, I think, a ministry. And we thank you for coming. Also, Diane Kelly and Desiree Flink, although they're not here, I guess took up that care in Jacksonville. So I wanted to mention them. And the Lord took care of my mom, and I think by providing stellar caregivers, and that we appreciated that so much. So anyway, I know we have a number of people that want to come up and talk, but I just wanted to say those things. And Mom, you're greatly loved.
My grandmother, whom I called Mama Too, was a woman of beauty and elegance, but nonetheless, she was very strong as well. Another of her attributes was generosity. She was very giving. She was a very giving person. Growing up, she would always give me and my brother gifts and clothes and other things like that. And I remember going to her house for the holidays for as long as I can remember. And she always had a big spread waiting for everyone. And she was always seeing to the needs of others and taking care of the people she loved. Not only that, she loved and took care of animals, too. Through the years, she had horses, dogs, peacocks, a bull, and a camel, to name a few. She got up before dawn in the morning and went to feed the animals, and she called it a labor of love. At that point, she'd already have her hair in curlers, and before you knew it, she'd be vacuuming or mopping or doing some other chore. She worked hard with no complaints. She had a very easygoing demeanor. She had a career in real estate at Watson Realty, where she specialized in horse properties, and she helped my parents find their farm many years ago. In terms of her faith, I know that my Mama Too spoke to our former pastor, Pastor Dan Davis, and he shared the plan of salvation with her about Jesus dying on the cross for our sins and raising again on the third day, and that if you confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And so Pastor Dan prayed with her to receive Jesus as her personal Lord and Savior. And I remember many years ago, and it might have been before that turning point in her life, we were visiting Mama Tu's house, and Uncle Don was there visiting, and my dad and my brother were throwing the football outside to each other, and my dad's wedding ring slipped off. And all I remember is that we were all bent down on the ground looking for his ring, and Mama Tu was there included, and we were having trouble finding it. So my sister-in-law, Holly, said, well, maybe we should pray about it. And my dad said, yes, let's pray. So my dad started to pray, and he asked the Lord to let us find the ring and let it be right now. And right as he said the word now, I heard my Mama Tu say, ta-da, and I opened my eyes, and I looked up, and she was holding the ring in her hand. And I was like, I was flabbergasted, and I was in awe of how God just answered that prayer in such a way as to show his power and love for us all. And he cares about little and big things in our lives and often works in mysterious ways to bring about his will of saving us by his grace through faith. And many years ago, the song I Can Only Imagine came out, and my Mama Tu had asked me about it one time because she liked that song. So I sang some of it for her, and I'd like to sing that song again today for her and for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and she doesn't have to imagine anymore.
What it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Yeah. can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Before I talk about Mom, I should also point out that Philip and Josie, by the way, has the flu or something equally evil today and is running a fever and is sparing all of you the opportunity to get it. So she's not with us today. But I will tell you that the last year or so, our mom's life, including these wonderful caregivers back here, Tiffany, Abigail, Sandy, Philip and Josie did an amazing job, absolutely amazing job. And toward the end, I would say probably February, March, April, Mom actually moved into their home. They set up a hospital bed, supervised the care, made sure that she got physical therapy. It was inspirational to see. And Joanne and I, of course, lived in New Jersey, so there wasn't too much that we could contribute to that, you know, other than phone calls and emails and text messages. But really, Philip and Josie really just did an amazing job in working with the very loving people that he has already thanked. So now let me talk about Mom a little bit. So my lovely wife here, Joanne, sitting in the front row, said it best. She said, Mom lived her dream life. And that is so very true. She really did live her dream life. So Mom left us at age 92, as has been said. But do you know how many people live to be 90 or 92 in this country? Anybody have any idea? It's like 4.7% of the population. So that really placed Mom in sort of that upper echelon. And of course, she was always in our upper echelon. But to be able to reach such a wonderful age was a tribute to a lot of things, including her will. And I will tell you this. I spoke with her last on Tuesday before coming down. And on Tuesday, I said, Mom, you know, Joanne and I are going to be down on Wednesday, and we get in sort of late, and we'll see you on Thursday. And she held out until we got there and had a few hours to spend with her. Her will was enormous. Mom had a long time to pursue her dream life. And what a great dream life she lived. I mean, she really did. It was amazing. Yeah, and we, her family, lived that dream life with her, and we all grew from it. It was an amazing experience to be part of that. So, you know, while most knew her strength of character, few actually knew of her resolute courage in the face of adversity. And she did face a lot of adversity in her life. She would never tell you about it. She wasn't one to share that with others. But she did face adversity. Several very serious illnesses, the loss of her husband, Al Houck, and Chip and Steve Houck are with us today. Thank you for being here. And then she lost her husband, Al, in 2001. Mom always said, you know, when you raise animals, death is part of life. She would say that every time a horse or a dog, one of her precious dogs, died. And it's true.
But Mom was always resolute. She was like granite, you know? She was like granite. She really was. Nothing ever broke her spirit. Nothing ever broke her love of life. Nothing fractured her resilience. Nothing would stop her dream life because she lived the life that she defined and wanted to live. Mom was adventurous. She rode motorcycles. I think there were pictures of the motorcycle up that were running in the loop earlier. But she rode horses. She rode motorcycles. She jumped horses. She and Al Houck lived aboard a 52-foot Chris Craft yacht in Washington, D.C., and then in Boston Harbor, where the boat unfortunately burned down in the middle of the night. Fortunately, they were not on it. They traveled extensively around the country. But then they came home, first to Mandarin, and then to Keystone Heights in 1998. Al passed away in 2001, closing that very special chapter of Mom's life. Some years later, another chapter began when a man by the name of Ken Brown, sitting over here behind my wife, was taking a walk down Crystal Lake Road, which is not far from here. As he approached Mom's house, he saw Mom watering flowers. He complimented her on the beauty of the flowers, the private person that Mom was, and I can just envision this. She thanked him and turned away. Ken, though, was persistent. He kept walking by until Mom weakened and one day invited him in to meet the horses. The rest, as they say, is history. Ken told me the other day, we were at Mom's bedside just before her passing, and he said, you know, your mother and I have been together for 16 years, and never once did we have an argument. I believe that, Ken. That was Mom. She didn't like to argue. She had her opinions. She had her positions. But she didn't like to argue. Mom was a peaceful soul, always supportive, always very supportive, particularly to Philip and I. And I like to think that she was too busy enjoying life to worry about arguing. You know, arguments often fill gaps in our lives. She didn't have room for that in her life. So I wish more of the world was like that, probably be a better world. Mom had quite the career. She had a long career. She began as a beautiful young model as World War II came to a close. So she was born in 1930, so she was, 15 years old or so when she began modeling. As a matter of fact, some of her modeling photographs are in the Florida State Archives in the photography collection. And I think one or two of them appeared on the screen a little bit earlier. The thing about Mom is that she was as beautiful inside as she was to the camera. And in my experience, having known many people, that's something of a rarity. Eventually, Mom got into real estate, first in Massachusetts and then here in Florida. For several decades, as Hillary noted, that she was with Watson Realty Corporation. Mom really did excel there. You heard the numbers. So no need to repeat them. But she was very successful. She was widely acknowledged as a specialist in horse properties. And if you wanted to raise animals and you lived in North Florida, chances are you went to see numerous properties with Mom and her black and white Chevy truck, and then you made an offer. But as much as Mom enjoyed her work, her dream life was about her family and her animals. Mom loved to cook, especially when we were all gathered at her house, holidays, and any other time that we all gathered together. It was always a time of joy there. And I don't ever remember one time, not once, when we were all together, was there ever an argument about anything. And the reason is that we valued that time together. We knew those were special times. We knew they wouldn't go on forever, so we knew they were special, and we always made the best of it. So it was always a time of joy. And that's something that we all need to remember. Like us, her animals never went hungry. Horses, donkeys, dogs, stray cats, birds, a hawk that would actually swoop down out of the afternoon sky and take pieces of meat from her. Right? How many of you experience that on a daily basis? It was really quite a treat to watch. She also had alpacas, a camel, a Brahmin bull, and a peacock that scratched the hood of her white truck. I'm going to tell you two very short stories about Mom. I was maybe 5 years old, and it was an incredibly hot summer. If you live here, and as most of you do, you know how hot it gets in July and August around here. It was that year, I know, an intolerably hot summer, as the best my memory at being 5 years old can recall. But Mom and our grandmother knew that the hot weather was going to dry up the water in all of the ditches and large puddles after a rain. She knew that was just going to disappear. So what does that actually mean? Well, it means that next morning, we loaded up our family Studebaker with fish nets and buckets. Right? And off we went in search of fish that were going to perish as the water evaporated. Now, we went from one side of Mandarin to the other, collecting fish, putting them in buckets, putting a little water in the buckets so they would survive. And we went to every ditch we could find, scooping out every fish that we could find, putting them in buckets, taking them to Julington Creek, and then doing the next round. We'd start all over again. Now, who does something like that, right? I have to confess, I don't know anybody else who's ever done that, right? I've never been part of the fish-saving squad after that. There were no news teams following us. There was no social media to note our efforts. Nobody was going to pat us on the back when we were finished saving these small fishes. Mom just loved nature, and she respected life. She often said that nature is a cruel force. Maybe this was her intervention in the forces of nature, a way to sort of stick it to nature. Who says those fish have to die? But that's what we did on that one day. The second story that I'd like to share set in motion values that we possess today, thanks to Mom. So Philip and I grew up in Mandarin. It was nothing like it is today. A couple of years ago, I was driving through Mandarin during the Christmas holidays and probably took, 20 minutes to go 100 yards. The traffic was so intense. But that's not how it was when we lived there. There was very little traffic. It was sort of a bucolic paradise. Yeah. Our elementary school was near home, and Mom would often ride her horse to retrieve us one at a time and bring our horses behind her. Now, who does that today? When's the last time your mom picked you up at school on horseback, right? If you did it in our neighborhood up in Manasquan, New Jersey, you'd be hitting traffic in about 5 seconds. So it was very special for us. And I think as a result of that, Phil and I felt very special that our mom would do that. Mom's attention was always focused on us, her family. She loved us, and she showed it. We always knew that we were loved, and that, my friends, is a gift that not everyone gives or receives. And yet, I assure you, it is a priceless gift. We share the values that Mom showed us in her everyday life, her dream life. Her courage, her resolve, the value of work, as Philip so accurately pointed out, the value of family, The gift of giving is greater than receiving. That was Mom. That was Mom. She was a giver. There are lots of takers in this world, and I'm sure we see them every day. She was a giver. So Mom will live in our hearts forever, and our values reflect her time with us as we live our dream lives, just as she wished for us. Thank you.
Well, I'm going to share a verse. This is found in Psalm 20, verse number 7. And getting to know Evelyn and Ken over the past many years was a joy, they said, right back over there. I think we know, we're talking before service, that I know there's some back issues, and I've often joked with folks in our church, I wouldn't mind getting some stock in Lazy Boy and just moving all the pews, putting Lazy Boys. You'd have to put a remote and a cup holder. Hopefully no one would snore, but that would not be so different than a normal sermon, I guess you could say. I told Ken, if we do that, just don't wake the person up next to you. But it was a joy to get to know, in small part, Evelyn and Ken over the last many years. And, of course, for the family, for the boys, for the grandchildren, for the great-grandchildren, for the friends, the relatives, the caretakers. It is a sorrowful time, but I do pray that as we conclude in a moment that it will give you time to reflect on, as he put it, a dream life, a life well lived. Well, I can't help but think of the time in which Evelyn was born. Think of 2023. What's happening now? The UN is, all the world leaders are meeting. We see what's going on in Europe or around the world. We see what's happening in Washington, what's happening in our country. But as the Roaring Twenties drew to a close, you know what happened at the end of the 20s? The stock market crash, which again brought about the Great Depression. We've often heard it said, I have an 11-year-old at home, I have a 23-year-old and two kids in between that. And people say, why would you bring kids into a world like this? Well, Evelyn's parents brought her into a world like that. Hitler had not yet risen to power. Mussolini was in power. Stalin was in power. And Herbert Hoover was the president at the time. But the year of her birth, I just want to give some context and perspective. The year of Evelyn's birth, 1930, Mickey Mouse first debuted as a comic strip. Betty Boop also debuted. And Looney Tunes, for the very first time, made their debut. In 1930, two famous outlaws would have their first meet, their rendezvous, Bonnie and Clyde. In fact, in Manhattan in 1930, they debuted the first red and green traffic lights in Manhattan. It was in 1930 that a little known place that we don't have in Keystone any longer, known as KFC, originated and started in Kentucky by Colonel Sanders. Pluto, the planet, was discovered in 1930 by an 11-year-old boy. The VA was created, and at Mount Rushmore, only one head existed, George Washington's head, and they dedicated it that year. In 1930, the year that Evelyn was born, the Hoover Dam began construction. Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, the writer of Sherlock Holmes and many other ones, he actually died the year that Evelyn was born. The first ever World Cup took place, and Broadway was created the year that Evelyn was born, and the Chrysler Building was completed, the world's tallest building for 1 year only, until 1931, when the Empire State Building was built and completed. I thought this was interesting. Scarface, who was a gangster, was jailed that year in 1930, the very year that Evelyn was born. And, of course, we all know that in 1930, the Great Depression began, 1,350 banks in the U.S. failed, and the Dust Bowl in our country began. So it was an era where the world had made it through, of course, in the 20s, at the tail end of the teens, when World War I was over, the world was still kind of, I guess, reinventing itself. And then it was great in the 20s, and it got real bad real fast in the 30s. In 1930, the jet engine was patented by a man from England. Scotch tape was invented, and the first time you could ever buy frozen fruit at your grocery store, it was in 1930. Let's just look at a little more perspective. The economy is kind of crazy right now, but what was it like to live in 1930 for Evelyn? To buy a gallon of gas was only 10 cents. A loaf of bread was 9 cents. A pound of hamburger meat was 13 cents. To buy a stove was $195. To rent was $15 a month. Would be kind of nice about now. The cost of a new house was $7,140 in 1930, and you would get paid yearly. The average wage was $1,970. And to buy a car, a big Pontiac, big six car, was $745. Evelyn came into this world with a bang. And many of the names I'm going to mention are some of the ones I really love watching on the big screen. But two in particular you know about that weren't on the big screen, but were in a big way. Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin were born in 1930, astronauts. The Big Bopper and Ray Charles, both born in 1930. Here's some names you might remember that you might identify with. Steve McQueen, born in 1930. Sean Connery, Sir Sean Connery. I love Sean Connery. Gene Hackman and Dirty Harry himself, Clint Eastwood, born in 1930. And I thought this was interesting. The year that Miss Evelyn was born, there was someone still living that would die the next year. And the reason we can have light bulbs today, Thomas Alva Edison was still living when she was born. He died in 1931. So in thinking of horses, I wanted to, you see the pictures of horses, you've heard the story, there's so many pictures and tales about horses. So in thinking of horses, we can't overlook the importance of horses in our civilization, in our country, in our world. And so the term or the phrase with horses is deeply ingrained in our language. And I wanted to give you some of these just as a tribute as we get into what God's Word says about horses. You know these terms. Back in the saddle. I got a Charlie horse. I'm chomping at the bit. You don't change horses midstream. That's just a dog and pony show. He's as healthy as a horse. She's got a burr under her saddle. Let's hit the trail. I could eat a horse. Let's ride shotgun. Send in the cavalry. They're just sowing their wild oats. Again, all relating to horses. You got that straight from the horse's mouth. He sure works like a horse. And you can see who holds the reins in that family. Again, all horse language. A couple other idioms that I thought were pretty interesting about horses. You might know what these mean, but I'll just share them. That's a horse of a different color. Don't look a gift horse in the mouth. That's a Trojan horse. Why don't you get off your high horse? Don't you have any horse sense? Whoa. Hold your horses. Boys, no more horseplay. Don't put the cart before the horse. Wow, Keystone is just a one-horse town. Maybe Mandarin used to be like that. Now it's no longer. That's a dark horse. You know what? That's her hobby horse. That's a bunch of horse hockey. Or as our president would say, malarkey. You can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. Why don't you stop beating the dead horse? And of course, we know about playing horseshoes and the like. Even the term horsepower used to be real horsepower. The horse was the most necessary instrument of welfare in the family and community prosperity and even national strength. Before automobiles, there were centers of supply of horses and mules for our nation and the world. In Fort Worth, Texas, and Memphis, Tennessee, people from all over the world would come to these two centers to buy horses for hauling wagons, pulling their plows, riding, or for use in war. In fact, you can see at the turn of the last century, World War I, many of those machines made by man began their trek across Europe and those nations, whereas before, horses were used, but the tanks now took their place. A man who had a horse or a woman had the advantage over someone that didn't have one. Someone once said that anyone who thinks all men are created equal has never met a man on foot who met up with a man on a horse. Even our culture shifted in daily affairs when the horse became available. My ancestry, my great-grandmother, American Indian, they changed some of their hunting habits once exposed to the horse. You could do things and travel distances that you couldn't before. The horse has been considered symbolic of strength, of endurance, speed, gracefulness, agility, beauty, and loyalty. I even think of Mr. Ed, right? I mean, again, a horse is a horse, of course, of course. At certain times in history, men have been preferred to be buried next to their horses rather than their wives. Archaeologists, you do see these in some of these chambers. It's quite amazing. But I do want to point your attention. What does God say? What does the Bible say about horses? If you study Scripture, over 200 times the term horse or horses are utilized. And of course, we know in this time, people would use camels, horses, mules, donkeys, but it appears over 200 times. And in the context of Scripture, horses always designate or emphasize strength and nobility or power. The Bible says that God created all the animals and he created the horses on day number six. It also says in the book of Job that God asked Job when Job was wondering, why am I going through this? He says, were you there when I created, Job 39, when I created the horse and gave him strength? The Bible mentions the horse frequently in the book of Revelation, which is the final book in the Bible. We read about the four horsemen, not the ones including Ric Flair and the others, but the four horsemen. That's the Antichrist, war, famine, and death. And they represent kind of the oncoming, relentless, unstoppable enemy that's coming. They all have one thing in common. All of these things are riding a horse. And then finally, in the last few chapters of Revelation, we read about how the Apostle John was allowed to see into heaven and to see the future. And as he looked in heaven, he saw the heavens open and Jesus was riding on something. Now, go back with me. Soon it'll be December. Let's not get there too soon. But the mother of Jesus rode on a horse? No, she rode on a donkey into Bethlehem. Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a horse? No, on a donkey. They came humbly. But when you read Revelation, it says Jesus is riding on a white horse coming back with all of those with him also on horses. So Jesus comes back, Revelation chapter 19 says, as the King of kings and the Lord of lords on a horse. James chapter 3 gives an interesting comparison. James, the brother of Jesus, half-brother of Jesus, he says, there are three things that are pretty mighty. There's a horse, there's wind, and there's a ship. And he said, one little bitty thing that you do to that horse can change the direction. You can tame that horse by putting a bit in the horse's mouth, and you can rein it in. We use these terminologies. You can have a small stern that affects the turning of the ship. And he says, we need to control our mouth. And he uses the analogy of a horse. Watch what you say. Control your mouth. And I think many of us often have trouble with that. Which brings us to our final verse. This is Psalm chapter 20, and this is verse number 7. And of course, David is speaking here, and David is talking about David was the king of Israel, the second king. David was the boy who beat the giant, who became the king, who fell from grace, rose back to power, had a great son, a great career. But in Psalm 20, verse 7, this is what he says. Some trust in chariots, and some trust in horses. But we will remember the name of the Lord our God. It's interesting. If we could paraphrase it, modern day vernacular, it would be like this. Some trust in their military might and their nuclear weapons. Or some trust in their financial stability and their retirement plan. Some trust in their career path and the kingdom they've built. Or you could fill in the blank. But he says, we trust in the name of the Lord. So in the world we live in, as we bring this to a close, I think we see this with political candidates that promise a utopia. they come and say, if you do this, support that, vote this way or vote that way, whatever the case may be, then all of this will usher in, you know, nirvana, utopia. But David is saying here, and Christians aren't immune to that. We often fall prey to these things. But David here is saying, some trust in horses and chariots, but my trust, I love my horse. I love my weaponry. I love my military might. I love the fact that I live in a palace. I love that it's the royal line and all of these things. But none of those things matter when it comes into a perspective with God. We can extend this concept of trusting in chariots and horses to our final thought, which is salvation. So various religions and belief systems advocate for salvation through their works. I was reading last night the story, maybe you've seen this, with Robert Redford. Many of you have watched the movie of The Horse Whisperer. And when you read the story of The Horse Whisperer and this gentleman that the movie and the book, the story is based on, I mean, this young man, he found solace in training horses and working with them, but somewhat unconventional. And this man had abuse as a child and the things that happened to him. And he looked at them as friends. He talked to them in a way that no one else could understand. And now celebrities, wealthy individuals, the world, I mean, Hollywood came to him and said, how do you do this? But as it relates to salvation, we can see that many in our world trust in maybe not the idea of a horse, but for you, a horse may be, you're hoping that the plan works out, that you have prepared all the years you've worked. You're hoping that your health, your stamina is going to hold out as long as you're hoping the relationship is not going to fail. You're hoping that, fill in the blank, that might be your horse. Even atheists and skeptics rely on their perceived goodness. They hope that if there is a God or there's something, that good deeds and the balances of the afterlife will be weighed and it'll be good. I won't come back as a dung beetle and be reincarnated. I'll get something else. They even hope. But Christianity is unique because the gospel invites us to trust in a person, not me, not a Baptist church, certainly, not in a brick-and-mortar building, not in someone that you've never met, you cannot see, someone in a different country, someone that founded a religion, whether you're Methodist, Pentecostal, Catholic, Mormon, Muslim, or non-religious. No matter what view you hold, Jesus said this, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, or you're burdened down. And he said this, I will give you rest. In fact, Jesus said, we started the service with it, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man, no woman, no person comes to the Father but by me. So if we want to have eternal life, we want to spend eternity with God, we want to know him, here's the challenge. We're going to have to dismount. We're going to have to get off the horse. And I don't want to spiritualize this to the point where, you know, whatever. We won't be riding a horse into heaven, so to speak. Meaning, the analogy, as David said, I had to trust in God and not in my own strength, not in the beauty of these animals, these creatures. And I believe what a great picture that Evelyn has left, a life of trusting in, training, raising, caring for, loving these animals. God has a lot to say about them, but you are God's most precious creation. You are. He created you, and he created you to have faith and trust. So if you're going to know God, if you're going to have eternal life, if you want to, as the Bible would say, go the way of Jesus, you're going to have to dismount. Don't put the cart before the horse. Don't put your works before the grace of God. Grace comes first. Grace, what God did for me at Christ's expense. Christ died in my place so that now I don't have to pull the cart of my own works. Lord, look at me. Look what I've done. I've worked really hard. Now I'm here at the pearly gates. Will you let me in? My works mean nothing once I leave this world. It might mean a lot to a lot of people while I'm living, and we should work hard. But it's the grace of God that changes our lives. So as we close, I've led you to water, but I can't make you drink. That has to be a choice that you make. You have to ask Christ to do something in your heart. You have to say to the Lord, I'm a sinner. I like how Hillary explained that, and she put it so well. We are sinners, but it's the grace of God. It's not, I'm not saved because I'm a Baptist or I'm a preacher or the son of a preacher. It's because at 11 years old, I trusted Christ. I had, are there 11-year-olds on high horses? Of course. But I had to dismount, and it was my mom, my mother, who led me to the Lord that night. She opened up God's word and said, this is what it means to know Jesus, to know God. And I couldn't rely on what my mom said. I couldn't rely on what my preacher said. I had to rely on what God's word said. So if anything I have been encouraged by as I have read God's word, I've read the beautiful eulogies and the obituary and heard the words and the stories, and even knowing and Ken and knowing Miss Evelyn, has been, it kind of pointed me back towards the Bible. God created these magnificent creatures. It is a symbol of strength and stamina and beauty. But strength, stamina, and beauty will fade. But when we know God and when we've met Christ, it's not who we are, our goodness. I can get off the horse, Lord Jesus. One of the best pictures I love is a painting of George Washington. He's there at Valley Forge, and it's a reimagining. He's kneeling in the snow, and you can see them there in his blues, and he's kneeling down, and his horse is right there beside of him. Like, that's such a cool picture. As a kid in the backyard where we grew up, I loved that we had a shed, and there was a little overhang. I would watch Gene Autry and Roy Rogers. And I don't know how they did it from the second story window, but they would jump out of the window onto the horse. I don't know. The Lone Ranger and Tonto, they would jump out, they'd get on that horse, and they would go. All of these movies, from Open Range to Clint Eastwood movies, whatever it might be, the horse, I mean, he has a role, a prominent role, or the movie, the cowboy movies would be kind of lame, wouldn't they? As you ride off into the sunset of your life, what are you trusting in? Who are you trusting? Who has the reins of your life? If it's the Lord Jesus Christ, he's going to lead you home. And there's no fear. There's no fear of death. I don't want to die. You don't want to die. But when we get to that point, our Lord will say, come on home. Table's spread. The door's open. Here I am. And he waits for us with open arms. And if you haven't met Christ and who he is, not what religion says, not what church says, not what your past experiences say, but what God's word says, you can trust him when you can't trust anyone else. So don't lift the gift horse in the mouth. Don't walk away being ungrateful for what Christ has done for you. And don't forget, he did it for you. He did it for you. He loves you. And I know we love Miss Evelyn. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for your word. Thank you for the admonition from your word. Thank you for the opportunity to share a bit about your creation. Lord, yes, you created all that is, this world, the sun, the moon, the stars, the sky, the trees, the flowers, the oceans, the fish, the animals, everything. But Lord, your most precious and prized creation is when you created man and woman, and you made them in your image, and you created us, Lord, to have a relationship with you. So, Lord, I pray that you would help us to remember that relationship and where we are in it. And if those who are here today don't know you and that saving grace, Lord, help them to call out to you, to dismount, to kneel down, and to say, Lord, I'm a sinner. You save me. I trust in what you've done for me on the cross. You will change my life. Now, Lord, help me to ride for your glory and to do what you've called me to do. Thank you for Miss Evelyn. Well, I pray that you would be with the family. You would help them, Lord, as they lay her to rest. Lord, I pray that you would help each family member and friend to take away today not only the memories that they have made together and the bonds, but, Lord, they would take something away from your word as well and how that you've created us for a special and unique purpose, one that we can fulfill, but only as we follow you. So, Lord, lead the way. We're willing to follow. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.